I was diabetic, and therefore I had to have my lunch at 1, so I went down for lunch. And there, I was just browsing my Twitter. Caught my attention was a tweet from a person whose handle is Mrs. Gandhi. Could be a young lady, could be a man pretending to be a young lady, doesn't matter. And the tweet is very interesting, and I welcome it. It says, "Super. Professor Dr. R. Vaidya 2000 slapping John Dayal on evangelism as a Rajiv message and Madhu Kishwa look on." Now, Madhu, I absolutely love. I've known her for 35, 40 years now. And I'm a great fan of hers from when she first burst on the scene and then created Manushi. And if R. Vaidya were bashing me up, and he is a very nice chap from Bangalore, and we just had a very nice talk, Madhu would have intervened and prevented me from being bashed up. I pointed it out not to introduce humor, although it's very, very funny, but possibly to point out that I am not participating in or speaking at the forum which this tweet seems to be about. I am participating in an intellectual discussion called by an institution for whom I have great regard because I knew its founders, one of whom passed away very recently this month, which is the Center for Study of Developing Societies. And because of my affection and respect for Madhu, and also I like to be a contrarian, and if there is to be a discourse, why should my voice not be heard? It doesn't take courage. Therefore, I'm here, not in the forum referred to in this tweet. I will not say by a tweet, because that would be disrespectful, by a person who possibly has assumed wrong about what this forum and such discourses are for. But we have only two options. There is no third option. The option is to talk and try to understand and try to reason and try to convince, and then either be convinced or not be convinced, or take out a gun or a knife, or if you're strong with a daikin or whatever, kill. And that is not my way. That's not my belief. I have two cheeks and I offer both of them. And then by turn, the same cheeks again and again. So my dear young friend, Mrs. Gandhi, let me tell you what I, in a small manner, did to the senior Mrs. Gandhi many years ago. When many of you were not born, can you just tell my son that I'm busy? One second, please. Yeah, Jason, I'm busy in a seminar. And I'll tell you about Jason also, very interesting fellow, Jason. I'll tell you about him in a minute. 1977, May, I published a book together with my colleague and friend Ajay Bose, For Reasons of State, Daily End of the Emergency. And both Learning Times and Ashai Chilbu were kind enough to review it. It's supposed to be excellent documentation of the emergency. And therefore, because of the emergency, I'm no great fan of the younger Mrs. Gandhi. So that is about Mrs. Gandhi that I don't want to talk. How about Jason? I must tell you about Jason. Jason is my son. He married a Hindu who is half Brahmin and half Khayasta from Chandanagar in Bengal. And they have a son, my only grandchild. My daughter is not married. And Kabir's mother, Sriyoshi Sarkar John, is a practicing Hindu. They got married in church, the Archbishop of Delhi presided. And every puja, Jason, because he is the son-in-law of that colony in Pashchim Vihar, which is a Bangla colony, he goes in the lead truck to buy the statue. And at the Visarjan, he goes in the lead truck colored red to deposit the Ma back in the river. My daughter-in-law has not been converted. My son is not converted. And because I boast of them, my brother did even bigger. His only child married a Muslim. And he also is not converted. Such is life. We are in the dialogue, Madhu, of life. Always have been. And therefore, I am not going to talk about the dialogue now because it exists. It's in the air. I'm a member of this center, and in the library sometimes you'll see Jagmohan. I wrote against him all my life. I still sometimes have tea with him. Dialogues are good. They asked me, what subject will you speak on? And I was wondering, why do they want to ask me? Because the seminar is towards a rational government policy for NGOs, for surely I will speak on a rational government policy on NGOs. And this is what I told them, that I'll speak on the need for NGOs. I am not here, Vaidya. I'm not here to defend Christ as a practicing Christian, as I say on TV. I would not follow any God I need to defend. He defends me, always. I'm not going to defend Christianity. 2,000 years, I'm just a passing phase. I'm not going to defend the church. I don't represent the church unless it's in the code of the Second Vatican, which says, I am the church. Every individual member of the body of Christ is the church. And certainly, I'm not going to defend the work of the church. I was for 4 years the president of the All India Catholic Union, Asia's largest and one of the oldest modern laity movements in the world. My whole job, those 12 years, was to fight with the bishops for a place for the laity in the sun, in the dialogue and the management of the church. So I'm not going to talk about that. I am going to talk about some comments on his research, some nice fellow social scientist comments. I'm a journalist professionally, and I make a living, I used to make a living, like several of my friends here, working for newspapers run by Lalas and some not run by Lalas.
Newspaper was not run by Lalas. But it was not run by Lalas.
Owned by Lalas and some not owned by Lalas. No. He and I are old friends. We are talking about things we know, which are, it's a private joke. No, can't share. Jokes.
Private joke
aired
publicly.
No, he has not aired the full joke. Partially. Well, what I wanted to say was, I am not an NGO. I am not a paid or unpaid employee of an NGO. I, like many of us here, live off my wife's earnings and a part of my earnings, which are going down because government has reduced the rate. I live on the interest of my savings. Therefore, I can afford to be critical. I live on those earnings, so I can speak. But I am a volunteer and have been so from when I joined St. Stephen's back in the early 60s. I can say, like some of you and many of you here, I have helped make a road with my own two hands. Not checkbook, not signed a check, to give it to a manager, to give it to a labor contractor, who will pay a laborer to bring the stone and lay the road. I've done it with my own two hands. That is volunteerism. So I also know that. Something, he said, and he has like me a sense of humor. You must mock evangelists. You must mock what is asked of me. Joshua programs, they don't represent Christianity. You must mock them. You must laugh at what they're doing. And sometimes marvel, why are they doing it? Because somebody said, I think you yourself said, or maybe somebody else, the worker, or maybe one of the questioners said, the person, illiterate villager, is not a fool. If he were to see hocus pocus, he would rebel. He would kick, he would scream. But let me praise all NGOs. And to prove the need for NGOs and the failure of government to do its duty. And the government has failed miserably. We keep on screaming about modernity and postmodern world and development. In Australia, a billionaire or a labor has a heart attack, he gets free treatment. And in Canada, absolute free treatment. Not in America. There's the NHS. I used to live in England once. There's the NHS, manned then largely by Indian doctors. It's free. Europe has a safety net. People freeze to death once in a while. But even if you're jobless, you can still afford to marry. Things will be taken. You won't starve. India has no safety net. I travel, as a journalist, I've traveled every district of this country, almost every mile of its borders. That's one good thing about journalism. You're doing it at other people's expense. The state does not reach. What good governance? There's not even bad governance there. There's no governance at all. And therefore, who will bring health? Not Christian NGOs. I'll come to the financing later. If the state will not enter out of pure love of heart, somebody has to enter. Who will? It's not an issue of transparency. It's an issue of addressing first aid, sending the ambulance, metaphorically speaking. Who will send it? And I congratulate the agencies that they have mentioned. I absolutely am fascinated by the RSS. I'm fascinated. I think the fact that they've announced that they run, and it's been confirmed now, 56,000 ekvidyalayas. We're not going into the content. We're not going into the pedagogy. We're not going into the textual material or even the psychological or political makeup of the teachers. Just the existence of the ekvidyalaya in 56,000 villages. And the fact that they've said that they will reach every village, which means 4 lakh villages if you follow data 1, and 6 lakh villages if you follow data 2. 6 lakh schools run by one organization, Indian funded. It's brilliant, I think. I may not agree with the thesis, but the fact that they can reach, and these groups, 100 and something, how many organizations, religious organizations, 300 odd organizations coming together in Chennai to announce to the world that they run 5 lakh schools and 6 lakh medical facilities, largely in South India. I think it's tremendous. If ever there was to be a Nobel Prize, it's not Satyarthi. It is collectively this NGO of India which should win this award. And please, whoever is attending the thing, convey my personal greetings to them and my felicitations on behalf of John Dayal, Mercy and John, my wife, and Kabir, my grandson. We congratulate them. We express our solidarity with the work, and we pray that the work increases. do convey, do not forget. Who else can do that? And I'm sure they do it with missionary zeal, because missionary is not a Christian word, a sense of mission, RK mission, Ramakrishna mission. This grammatical illiteracy of thinking that every missionary is white, like two of my friends in this room, is not valid. Missionaries look like Japanese, Buddhist missionaries, they look like similar. And as a reporter covering Sri Lanka in the 80s when the war was on, and this terrible misfortune of being mistaken for a Tamil in Colombo because I was dark and did not know Sinhala, and being mistaken for a Sinhala in Jaffna because I was dark, tall, and did not know Tamil. So Raka, don't laugh. Missionaries are colored like me, they're colored like you, anybody who works like a mission. And therefore I congratulate the RSS missionary and the religious, I presume the Hindu religious missionaries and not Buddhist or others, although it is in South India. I congratulate them for the work. Who else would do that work? And compared to that, the church work is insignificant. 5 and 5, 10, and another 14 lakhs, just between 350 organizations. The church work is only 50,000. After 200 years, foreign funding is insignificant, it's inconsequential. It is incapable of changing the political, social, economic, or any other discourse in this country. Do not bear it. Because bringing it up diverts our attention from supporting the need for voluntary work. Sorry. Chumma sir, ash panna mathiya. We will divert attention from a vacuum, a wound that needs to be healed, dressed, a child who needs to be educated, that AIDS person from the Himalayas, where I spent all my early years till I was 14, from Kashmir to Dehradun. We will be diverting attention away from that AIDS worker and that AIDS patient, more important than the worker, and from this illiterate children in villages, and putting it on state. How is the state threatened? How is India threatened? India is threatened far more by AIDS and by tuberculosis and malaria and poverty and disease. I'm a diabetic. I measure my blood 4 times a day, take insulin. Very, very expensive. My insulin bill is 15,000 rupees a month. And suppose I didn't have the money, every poor diabetic would die, and they do die, undiagnosed. A poor diabetic below the poverty line doesn't exist, he's dead. I exist because we spend money. Do not divert attention from the trivia of evangelization. The senses will tell you you're barking up the wrong tree. And I use the word barking without any malice. I love dogs. My first one was Doggy, lived 14 years. The second was Julie, lived 14 years. The third was Ruby, lived 18 years. The sixth was Gina, lived 6 years, died of a kidney failure. So painful, I and my wife decided we will never have a dog again. So that's the labor we do for a dog. How much more for a man? Do not divert attention. I am all for transparency. Surely, I want every organization to be under RTI, with the RTI questioner also telling us why he wants to have the information. He can ask me my income tax, because the government asks me when I file it. He can ask me who I'm married to, because the census asks me. cannot ask me other private details. Have I stopped beating my wife? Can't ask me that. That's private. And I want the same rights and the same culpability to every organization. Government of India, from the president downwards, members of parliament, and they have to file. But who is to test whether what they filed in an affidavit is true or not? Even I, poor man that I am, must be richer than half of the ministers and all the MPs, it would seem. And I drive I-10, but I have 46 lakh rupees in FD after 46 years of work. That's how I live, that's how I'm a member of the IIC. Many of you are not, I don't know who are. I want that. I want the NGO sector and the political parties also to be RTI. Why not? I will finish in 5 minutes. Please give me transparency. I'm all for the law being implemented. In fact, most of my 46 years in life have gone into advocacy for rule of law. How can you not have rule of law? I want rule of law. I want the worst Indian law, till it is changed, to be implemented in full against everybody who sins, who breaks that law. Christian, Muslim, Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, why not? What I am against is targeting. Kick me for my ignorance. Try to sell me fair and lovely, an imami. Do that. You can. But don't target me for things I do. Things I cannot change or I don't want to change. Don't target me in the north for being dark. I have the unique distinction of being the only dark child in my school in the Himalayas. It has never been a disadvantage. I was exotic. I used to travel in North Europe. The horses loved me. I was the only exotic in the damn plane. Do not target. Don't change goalposts. Define your terms under the IPC, under the CRPC. What is national? Define it. What is anti-national? Define it. What is national interest? Define it and I'll obey it. Why do you have a culpability clause in a nuclear treaty if you do not in your heart of hearts think that somewhere, God forbid, my God and your God, forbid if something happens? Because my brothers and sisters, my dear sons and daughters, I was Indian reporter number one in Bhopal at a coming from outside, apart from the reporters who were in Bhopal. And we went there. When foreign reporters were coming with gas masks and water bottles, because they heard that the air was polluted. We went there. At times, our India Today girl reporter fell ill in the morgue of Hamidiya Hospital, because the bodies, as they were collapsing, in the lungs was MIC, the poison gas, and it was being exhaled in the air. She fell ill. She left journalism. You know her. She left journalism. Bhopal can happen. Chernobyl can happen. The 3 Mile Island can happen. And therefore, the BJP struggled and opposed the law. And even now, wants a cartel of LIC, of insurance companies, to take care just in case it happens. So there is a doubt, it can happen. Which is natural interest? Power is very important, and there are alternate sources also. So is nuclear national, international? I'm not going to. Is thorium national, international? Malalis, my cousins, have lived there for generations without getting cancer, but that doesn't mean a damned. Concentrated, encapsulated, who knows? define national interest. Polluting the Ganga is anti-national, more than anything else. Define your terms, and I'm okay with them. I may differ with PRS, and I may differ with Venkatesh. Where is he? Ah, hi. I love your work. Define your terms, and it is okay. Do not change goalposts. And I told you I love the RSS. Not because Jesus says, love the enemy as thyself. Kupali Sudarshan was a friend. I don't know Mr. Mohan Bhagwat. One of these days I will know him also. But I do know Mr. Narendra Modi. He's a good friend of mine. And sometimes little children who see me on TV, if their father who knows me asks, who is this chap, they'll say, Modi uncle. Because on TV I somehow sometimes look like him, I think because of the beard. We would like to have a dialogue, even on what role, how to define rational. There must be a government policy. Why not? It's the government's business to be in the business of making laws. Let them make the laws. Let them define the laws. Let them implement the laws. Let government do its job. And if possible, make it impossible to find NGOs, to find a niche in which they can work, because the government would have done everything that the people need to live like human beings and not to die like my beloved Gina, who was just a dog. Thank you so much.